Okay, so how is everyone today? Good? Because there's no homework due today because last Monday was Martin Luther King Day. But there's homeworks due on Wednesday and Friday. Any questions about the currently pending assignments? So another thing that's open is quiz number one. It's open at the testing center now. Okay, last time we were talking about polynomials, and we're still talking about polynomials. So let's have an example. So for example, 5x squared minus 7x cubed plus 6x plus 10, and then from this let's subtract the polynomial. Minus negative 4x cubed plus 9x plus 3. So we've got two polynomials, the one and the other, and we want to subtract them. So the first thing to do is to deassociate. And I mean a mathematical operation, not a psychological one. Okay, what I mean is to rewrite this with no parentheses. Okay. So as for the first polynomial, we can just remove its parentheses. Nothing really is required. Just recopy it without the parentheses. As for the second polynomial, little bit of work is required. What? Right. So we're saying subtract this whole polynomial. Subtract all of it. So that means that we're subtracting each individual term. And the way this can be reckoned is by distributing the negation to each term. So to remove the parentheses, after they're removed, what will be the term corresponding to this one? Plus 4x cubed. And then what's the next one? Minus 9x. And then the last, minus 3. Okay, so any question about that? Now we need to combine like terms. So for four polynomials, what does it mean for terms to be alike? So this is like in grade school when your teacher says something like, you know, if Jack has 4 apples and 3 oranges, and Jill has 7 apples and 1 orange, then how many of each do they have together? So apples are alike and oranges are alike. But you can't say if you have 3 apples and 4 oranges, then you have 7 apples. It doesn't work this way. So my question to you is what makes polynomial terms alike? The degree. It's the degree that has to be the same in order for them to be alike. So what we want to do is combine all of the terms of the same degree. And furthermore, I want you to provide your answer in standard order, standard form, standard representation, which means what?
The highest degree is first.
Highest degree is first. So among all these terms, what is the highest degree? 3, which means that we need to combine all such terms together. Well, here's a degree 3 term. Here's a degree 3 term. So negative 7 of them and then 4 more of them. So how much cube do we have? So negative 3x cubed. So negative 3x cubed. So now we've dealt with all the cubes. Okay, what's the next highest term?
Square.
The squares, yeah. Degree 2. Okay. So, and we just have this one. There's nothing to combine it with, which is to say that we can just copy it down here. Okay, next. The degree one terms. So we've got 6x and minus 9x. How much is that? Minus 3 of them. And now the units. How much?
7.
Any question about this example? No, it is not necessary for you to draw a wiring diagram in your answer. But since this is the first one, I thought I'd try to make it as clear as possible. Okay, so then polynomials can be added and subtracted in exactly this way. Okay, you combine like terms. You distribute subtractions as necessary. Okay, the more interesting phenomenon that we have to deal with is multiplication. So any question about this before I go to the next page? Okay. So here's a long remark about the product of polynomials. So first, we're going to consider a plus b multiplied by c plus d. So a, b, c, and d each themselves stand for a term in a polynomial. So for example, a might stand for 4x, and c might stand for 7x cubed, some term in a polynomial. So in this product, this factor has two terms in it. So now the name polynomial, literally transliterated, means poly means many, and nom means name. So polynomial, many names. So in our case, it means many terms altogether. So this, because there's exactly two terms, we have a more specific name for this. This is referred to as a binomial. A binomial. What do you suppose we call a polynomial with three terms in it? A trinomial. And quadrinomial, blah, blah, blah. But I don't know the prefixes after that, really. So binomial. So this formula that we're dealing with, the mathematician's name for it is product of binomials. Product of binomials. So that's the mathematician name. Now students have a different, very common name for this. So let's not say it out loud if you know what it is. Let's see if you can catch it by the time we get to the end. Okay? Students have a very common name for this. So let's try and figure out what the formula is, and we're just going to follow our nose. Which is to say, I'm going to consider this as a single object, a plus b, and I'm going to distribute it across that sum. So c, you're going to get an a plus b, and d, you're going to get an a plus b. So we're going to perform the distribution. And if we do that, then the first thing on the right-hand side is a plus b multiplied by c. And then what else do we also get? A plus B times D. Okay. So we want to multiply this out completely. So more distribution. So now here's a C. B, you're going to get a C. And A, you're going to get a C. And for the D, B, you're going to get a D. And A, you're going to get a D. So we're going to perform that distribution. So here's a distribution. Here's another distribution. Remember, I don't want you to say it out loud, but I do want you to try to beat me to the punchline. What is this thing that we're making? So if we do that, just corresponding to this thing, what will we get? Just that part.
AC plus BC.
Very good. AC plus BC. And then for the last, what do we get?
AD plus BD.
Plus AD plus BD. And then for some reason that may not be entirely clear yet, I'm going to rewrite this as AC plus AD plus BC plus BD. So what did I do from the first to the last line? Alphabetized it. Okay, I like that. So specifically, this one moved over here, and this one here. So in alphabetizing it, I had to change the order of the addition. Is that a legal maneuver to change the order? Yes. Why is it legal? Fishing for a C word. The commutative property of addition. Okay. So now, remember, you're trying to beat me to the name, to the student's name of this formula. Okay. So now, this is the product of binomials. The product of binomials, and that's one of them. And there's two terms in it, A and B. So now I'd like you to consider A. How would you refer to A? Would you call it the first one or the last one? First one? Okay. How about considering C and D? Which one is first?
C.
C. And look, here we've got both of the first ones together, right there. So let's call this one the F term. Okay. So now, concerning this one again, among A and B in the first binomial, which one would you call last? B. And how about in that one? D. So then, do we have B and D together somewhere? All right here, right? So let's call this the L term. Okay, so now I won't break the suspense anymore. So what's this called? Foil, right? So now let's see. Well, concerning this product, okay, and now considering A, B, C, and D all together, just visually, which pair would you say to be the outside pair? A and D, right? Those are the ones outside. Those are the ones on the outside. And then which pair would you consider to be the inside pair? B and C. So that's why this is referred to as FOIL. Okay, neat little catchy name. But I'd like to point out that all that FOIL really is, FOIL is just a convenient formula that hides for you 1, 2, 3 distributions in a commutation. That's what it is. It's a short way to do 1, 2, 3 distributions in a commutation. So now let's practice with it.
So for example, 3x plus 4 multiplied by 6x plus 5.
So since this is the first example, I'm going to do it in overwrought detail. But I don't expect you to do it in quite this much detail going forward. So what is the F pair, the F term? Which ones go with it?
3x
and 6x. So 3x, 6x. The outside pair? 3x and 5. Okay. The inside pair? 4 and 6x. And then the last pair? 4 and 5. Okay, now I don't really expect you to write it like this. I'm just writing it this way since some of you may be seeing this for the very first time. But that's F, O, I, and L. Now under normal circumstances,
students just do these things in their head, right? Which is to say that students don't usually write 3x and 6x. Rather, you just multiply it out.
If you were to multiply it out, what would you get?
18x squared. Because the 6 can commute to the front, and then you have 3 times 6 is 18, and then you have x times x, and the short way to write that is x squared. Similarly, how about this one? 15x, and the next, 24x, and the last one, 20. And then every time I ask of you for a polynomial, I want it to be in standard form. Is this in standard form?
No.
It is not. In what way is it not in standard form? Right, that can be combined. So let's do that. So this would be 18x squared plus how much? 39x plus 20. Any question about this one? Okay, so now let's do another one, but let's do it slightly more rapidly. How about 2x minus 5 multiplied by 6x plus 7? Okay, now what will be the f term?
12x.
Very good. And then the o? 14x. And then the i?
30x.
Not almost.
Minus 30x.
Right, minus 30x, right? Because it's negative 5 times 6x. And then what will be the L?
Minus 35.
Minus 35. So computationally, this one is just slightly different than the previous one because I didn't write the individual pairs. I did it in my head. And then when you've done a lot of these all together, then you start doing the O and the I all together in your head. But we didn't do it that way, so now we've got to write one more line, which is to say that this would be 12 x squared and then minus 16x minus 35. Any question about this? Well, okay. This, everybody has this page? Okay, next thing. So it's a continuation of the previous remark about products. So now what we're going to consider, okay, what if both of the binomials are the same? Which is to say, if they're both a plus b. So in such a case, then it's a plus b times a plus b, which you write as a plus b squared. So now, I'm going to write something that is incorrect. And if you're going to copy it, then you need to also copy that it is incorrect. So what I'm going to write is the most common error that students make. The most common error that students make for this formula is to write that it is a squared plus b squared. So this is not correct. This is wrong. Okay. Now, it almost makes sense. Almost. Because if you compare it, say, to right here, then what is this called when the b gets a c and the a gets a c? What's that called?
Distribution.
Distribution, right? And the reason why is because product distributes over sum. Product distributes over sum. And we have another arithmetic operation, exponentiation. Exponentiation distributes over product. So you've got product distributes over sum, exponentiation distributes over product, but exponentiation does not distribute over sum. Doesn't work that way. Notice that here we have sum, and then what is this?
Exponentiation.
So this is what the formula would look like if exponentiation did distribute over sum. That's what it would look like. So I can kind of, like, on that level, I can kind of understand why a student might think that this is right. But it simply is not. Okay. So now let's make it right.
So a plus b squared means a plus b multiplied by a plus b.
So that's the product of binomials. If only we had a formula for the product of binomials.
That's what we do, right? So then what is the f term going to be for this?
A squared.
The O term?
AB.
The I term?
BA.
And the L term?
B squared.
Right, that's FOIL. So now I'd like for you to consider the terms in the middle. What can we say about the terms in the middle?
They're the same.
I do agree. Why are they the same?
You can switch the letters around.
Okay, I agree that you can switch the letters around.
But what's the math name for that? Vision for a C word.
Commutative, right? Product commutes. So now, I hope at this point you're kind of thinking, gosh, this instructor is really on those math vocabulary words. Well, yes. Okay, for one reason, this is a math class.
For another thing, you're going to find that in whatever it is that you're doing, when you want to talk about something precisely, some things do commute and some things do not. And a lot of mathematics and science is figuring out just in what way do things commute or not. So, for example, if I was to ask all of you to write to exactly now submit for inspection, and I'm going to check your socks, there'd be no way for me to tell whether or not you put your left sock on first or your right sock. I can't tell. It's not possible. Putting your left and right socks on commutes. How about putting on your left shoe and your left sock? Does that commute? It doesn't commute, right? The result is quite different if you do sock first and then shoe, or shoe first and then sock. Okay. Even more outrageous, right, is something like pants and underwear. One way you're Clark Kent. The other way you're Superman. Right? Totally different. So,
that being said, we can rewrite this formula. As a squared plus 2ab plus b squared.
Here's a formula. Which, from this point forward, I now assume you have memorized. So this thing in the middle is in a sense how much this formula was off. So this is the extent to which exponentiation does not distribute over sum. That term in the middle.
So let's have an example. How about x plus 8 squared
x squared.
First term is x squared. What's the last term?
64.
So is everybody okay with the first and the last one? The only one that ever causes any problems is the one in the middle. So what's the middle term? 2 times 8x.
Which is 16x. And if you like
working it out as FOIL in your head, when you do 8 times x, you'll do 8 times x, and you'll get 8x. And then you do x times 8, and you get another 8x. So altogether, you have 16x's. Okay, any question about this one?
Okay. How about 5x plus 7y, and we'll square that. Okay. So now, what do you get for the first term? 25x squared. Is everybody okay with that? 25x squared. What do you get for the last term? 49y squared. So is this okay? Okay, then my question for you is okay, what do we get in the middle? 70xy. 70xy. Okay, so can someone in plain language explain why it would get 70xy? Yeah, okay. So we do it first in this one, right? So 5x times 7y, well, that's 35xy. And then 7y times 5x, that's another 35xy. So we have 70 of them. Is everybody okay with this? Last one. Two W plus 3Z squared. And now, I'm telling you right now that I am attempting to underhandedly mess you up. I'm telling you. Okay, so what's the first term?
4w squared.
What's the last term?
9z squared.
9z squared. And now I want each of you to think about what you got. And I'll ask, what's the middle term? 12wz. It's 12wz, but I suspect between five and ten of you got 6WZ. You got half as many of them as you're supposed to have. Okay, so 12WZ. So I want to explain to you so you don't fall prey to it again or in the future. So what's happened is that you know that there's this formula here has this 2 here. So you need to understand this about the way your brain works as a computational device. You have this 2 here in the formula, and then I put a 2 here in this exercise. And what happens is that these two 2s can get mixed up in your brain. And a large percentage of students, the middle term will be, they'll provide half as many as what's necessary. But understand, it's 2w times 3z, so there's 6wz. And then 3z times 2w, so there's another 6wz, so there's 12 of them. Any questions about this? So, no need to raise your hand, but if I got you here in class, don't let me get you when it counts.
Okay, now, a minus b squared.
So now it's really quite similar to the previous one. Okay, the distinction being only instead of a plus b, it's a minus b. Again, here I'm writing the wrong answer. The most common wrong answer is this.
that would be the answer if exponentiation distributed over subtraction, but it just does not. So
rather, we need to do this exactly in the same manner as the previous one. So A minus B multiplied by A minus B. And then we do this with FOIL. The F term is A squared. What's the O term?
Minus
AB. The I term?
Minus
BA. And then the L term?
Plus
B squared. Because?
Because we have negative B times negative B, then the negatives square away, so we're left with B squared. Similarly, we have AB and we have BA. These are the same, and we're subtracting it twice.
So we have A squared minus 2AB plus B squared.
And here's another formula that, from now on, I expect that you have memorized. These two formulas are very similar. There's literally, visually, a pin stroke difference on the right-hand sides. What's the difference? The minus 2ab. Notice both of these have a positive a squared and a positive b squared. They both have the positive ones. Okay. So, for example, how about 6x minus 4 and square that. So what do you get for the first term? 36x squared. And then in the middle?
Minus
48 of them. 48x. And then?
Plus
16.
Any question about this one? So now, the next product we're going to deal with is, so notice in comparison here, so for the top one we did a plus b and another a plus b, and then for the bottom one we did a minus b and another a minus b. So for the last one we're going to do one of these and one of those. We're going to do an a plus b and an a minus b, but it nevertheless is just another example of FOIL. Oops.
So, fourth one, A plus B multiplied by A minus B.
So we're going to make another FOIL argument in a minute, but first, I'd like to point out that we already have names for these expressions. Notice that we have a plus b and we have a minus b. They're both binomials, but these binomials are said to be blank to each other. What is it? Conjugate to each other.
So this formula that we're dealing with is called the product of conjugates.
Okay, because those two things are said to be conjugate to each other. Okay, well, let's just follow our nose
with FOIL. So what is the F term?
A squared.
The O term?
Minus
AB. The I term?
Plus BA.
And the L term? minus b squared. So this is
straight FOIL. Any question about getting these four terms? Now, notably, and in contrast to the previous two, what is going to happen? What happens to the middle terms? They cancel, right? Here, we get a negative ab, and here, a positive ab. As opposed to the previous two, where we got a positive ab and then a positive ab. Or a negative ab and then a negative ab. Here we got one and one, and they're gone.
As a result, the formula is a squared minus b squared. So a plus b multiplied by a minus b
is a squared minus b squared. And here's a formula that, again, from now on, I assume that you have memorized. So now, this, the left-hand side is referred to as product of conjugates, for reasons that I hope are obvious. The right-hand side is referred to as the difference of squares, because that's a square, and that's a square, and they're being subtracted. So when you say this out loud in spoken language, you say that the product of conjugates is the difference of squares. Okay, and the reason why I'm saying that is because what we're doing is we're going from the left-hand side to the right-hand side. We're going, in a sense, that direction. But the next topic is we're going to go that way. As I'm going to give you this, and you're going to have to give me that. Okay,
so let's have an example. So how about x minus 7 multiplied by x plus 7?
So in the first matter, observe that this is the product of binomials. So in principle, you could just use FOIL. Do you also observe that this is the product of conjugates? So that you could, in that way, use a shortcut formula.
So what is the first term? X squared. And what is the last term?
49. Minus 49.
Minus 49.
Any question about this one?
Okay, how about 5p plus 6q multiplied by 5p minus 6q? So again, product of conjugates. What will be the first square?
25p squared.
Good. 25p squared. And then minus the second square? 36q squared. Any question about this one? This is okay. Last one. How about w minus the square root of 3 multiplied by w plus the square root of 3? So what do you think? What's the first square? W squared. And then?
3.
Minus 3. So I'm going to write something, because a lot of students have difficulty with this. I'm going to say minus the square root of 3 squared. Writing this intermediate step seems to help a lot of students. But now, what is the square root of 3 squared? 3.
Yes?
Isn't this the same when you're rationalizing the
quite similar. And
Yes. So let's make that point, is that observe in here where the O and the I, they cancel. Okay, that's that cancellation, that feature, that arithmetic feature, is part of the reason why these terms, these binomials, A plus B and A minus B, are said to be conjugate to each other. It's the same arithmetic thing that happened when we were finding common denominators. Exactly the same principle, is that the middle thing, the things in the middle cancel. Pretty good. Also, I like writing examples like this because W's and 3's look so similar, right? W, 3, W, 3. It's terrible. Okay, so any questions about this? So to summarize this product remark, we had four products. A plus B multiplied by C plus D. The mathematician's name for this is product of binomials. The student's name for this is?
FOIL.
That is AC plus AD plus BC plus BD. FOIL. Then we said, well, let's do the product of binomials, but let's make the binomials the same. So we're squaring them. Okay. Then A squared plus 2AB plus B squared. Okay. And then what about subtraction? Because that exists too. So what if we square a difference? Well, how is this similar yet different from the previous formula? Correct. So now it's A squared and then minus 2AB, but we still have plus B squared. And then the last formula is, well, what about when we take the product of conjugates, which is in a sense where you say,
let's take one of the factors from that formula and one of the factors from the next one.
Then this is now the difference of squares. A squared minus B squared.
Any question about this? Okay, good. So any question about this page before we go to something a little different? Okay. So what about,
for example, find the shaded area. And if I was to give you this, so here's a right triangle, and I'll say that the vertical side is, say, 2x plus 6, and the horizontal side is 5x plus 4, and then right here is something like a circle with radius x, and what's shaded is all of the stuff in the triangle that's not in the circle.
Like a piece of Swiss cheese or something. Okay. So, what I want is the shaded area. So, getting into this class, among the presumed knowledge is the formulas for the areas of shapes such as these, triangles and circles. Okay, so then using the names base and height, would you please remind me of the formula for the area of a triangle?
Base times height
over 2. Okay, and then using the name radius, would you please remind me of the formula for the area of a circle? Pi r squared. pi times the radius squared. Okay, another matter that all human beings intuitively know, but needs to be explicitly stated in a math class, is that area is translationally and rotationally invariant, which is to say, here is an area, and if I move it over here, I didn't change the area. If I move over to here, it's not changed, not changed, not changed, not changed, not changed. It can be translated. Here's an area. That's the same area. Area is rotationally invariant. That's the same, all the same. So as long as I don't squeeze it, or something weird like that, then the area is the same. Okay. As a result, this gives us a method to deal with this exercise.
And the way that you deal with it is like this. Is that, well, what we really want is we want the area of a shape that looks like this.
But that's not one of the shapes that we know, right? Circle, triangle?
What, Mrs. Harris didn't go over that. Okay, but we could do this. We could say, well, it must be the area of this one. And what else? Minus the area of the other one, right?
Must be this, if you take my meaning. Not, it's not real legitimate math, but I think you understand what I mean.
So this, let's write down the formula. So it would be 1/2 base times height for the triangle, right? So half, and instead of writing base times height, I'm going to write height times base. In the first place, that doesn't matter because multiplication is commutative. But I want you to think just for a moment, why is it that I would do that? Again, while you're thinking about that, what will be the formula for the area of the circle?
Pi x squared.
Yeah, pi r squared. So pi times x squared.
Okay, so instead of writing 1/2 base times height, I wrote 1/2 height times base. What expedient purpose might I have in doing that? Right. So have a look at the coefficients here and here. Would you rather distribute the half to that one or to the other one? To the first one, right? Because this one, all the numbers are even, so the half goes away. But if we were to do it to this one, then we get fractions, and that would make us sad, right? No one likes that. So does everyone see? Ah, okay, that was convenient. So, you know, keep your eye out for little convenient things like that. If you were to distribute the half into the first binomial, then what would you get?
X
plus 3. And then as for the other one, it would be unchanged, 5x plus 4, and then minus pi x squared. So now, on such a question, I would say simplify your answer. This is the product of binomials. If only we had a formula. Oh, but we do. So then, now on this one, if you haven't been practicing already, so I want you to do the FOIL thing, but see if you can do the O and the I all in your head. Which is to say, the f, that would be 5x squared, and then seeing if we can do the o and the I all in our head, well, the outside, that's 4x, and the inside, that's 15x, so how much x is that? 19x, right? So I know that some of you think I'm kind of belaboring the point. Bit. And I am. But some people are just now doing this for the first time. And then plus 12. And minus x squared. Okay, and now, is this written in standard form? It is not. In what way is it not written in standard form?
The x squared.
Got to combine those.
So somehow we're supposed to write something x squared plus plus 19x plus 12.
And what are we supposed to write right there?
5 minus pi in parentheses. Now, you may look at that and be a little bit disturbed that you can't write something neat like 7 or whatever, but that's just not the way it is. Okay, it's just not the way numbers are. There's nothing wrong with that number. Now, we're figuring out the shaded area. So if we were talking about paint or something, and then probably you could say, well, that's about 2. Right? 5 minus pi, that's about 2. Okay, but in math class, 5 minus pi is 5 minus pi. Okay, have a nice Monday.